How are you today?
I'm very good. Actually, in New Orleans.
Good. How's the tour going?
Really well, actually. Very good.
You're nearing your 30th year.
Coming up, yeah.
Do you have any big events planned?
Not much. I think 30 is not such a, you know, stellar anniversary as, like, let's say 50 or 100, but, or 25 for that matter. But there's a bunch of releases, old stuff that has never been put out on vinyl. It's going to come out. There's going to be a new album, a tour, the usual stuff.
Great. And I want to talk about the beginning of your band. So it started because of a very interesting art project.
Yep.
How did that project happen?
I have no idea. I was not really involved with the happening. I was just basically hired as a driver, because all those guys that were doing the sculpting and painting, they were like heavy alcoholics, and they needed someone to make sure they got to Paris. Mm-hmm. So they asked me to drive them, and I did. And then somehow on the drive it came up like, it would be nice to do some audio. Is there anything you can do? And I was like, I can make some noise.
Right.
And that's how it started.
Mm. So you were involved with music before that?
Yeah, yeah.
Were you in bands, and what did those bands sound like?
I played in bands, I played the bass, and they were like, you know, punk rock bands, like kind of playing in like small youth centers, you know, for like a case of beer or something like that. Mm.
Did industrial exist at that time?
Oh yeah, industrial was definitely around, and I was a huge fan of early industrial stuff, SBK and Throbbing Gristle and stuff. Mm. But I had no ambitions to really, you know, do anything with music. I was more like working as a photographer, as a day job, and I was working in a publishing company. So this whole band stuff was kind of on the side. It wasn't really important.
Right. And it became important, I guess.
Yes, it did. It did. Once I discovered the ins and outs of recording studios, I was like, I was hooked. Because I'm a very tactile person, so when I walk in a room with like 10,000 knobs, I'm like, yes! What does this do? What does that do? And that's how I learned it.
Right. So industrial seemed to peak in the 90s, but now it seems like all those really great 80s and 90s industrial bands are getting really popular again. Have you noticed that as much?
I don't know. I mean, KMFDM has never sort of slumped in that sense. We always bring out records and touring, and I'm just really surprised, in a good way surprised, to see that our audience stays very young. You know, it's not like we're playing all of a sudden we're like 40 and older, but there's young people coming to the show, so I think that's a really good, that's a really good sign, and it's an important factor in KMFDM's longevity as well.
And you said you've got releases coming out on vinyl. Do you still like vinyl, or do you like just digital music?
I always loved vinyl. I always preferred the large format, especially with KMFDM's artwork. That's, you know, the perfect presentation of that kind of stuff. If you have to look at it on an iPod or something, you don't get that greatness. But if you carry a piece of vinyl, you're like, wow.
Right.
So. And vinyl has a huge resurgence. I mean, people are buying vinyl like this for tomorrow.
Definitely. Is there anything else you'd like to say?
I want to say thank you, New Orleans, for having us.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hey, I'm Sasha from KMFDM, and this is
Lucia.
And we're going to answer 20 questions on metal injection.
Rebels in Control.
Drug Against War.
Eat.
Good food. Don't we look the part?
Yeah, you know, it's hard. Not, you know, eating, getting good food on the road. So when you have time to get something really substantial and delicious, you're very happy.
Bombay Sapphire Gin, most definitely, yeah. Or Smith & Wesson.
Not.
I think swimming with great whites in Australia. Not knowing they were there.
Yeah, I would have to agree with you on that. That was a pretty frightening, simultaneously frightening and exciting experience.
It was exhilarating. I never downloaded anything. I buy records. We just basically picked the ones that we would love to play live on a live set, you know. It's not a best of compilation in that sense. It's more like a personal favorite type of selection. Yeah. No,
well, it's always the worst experience, and it hasn't only happened once. It's probably after a very late night going to sleep and having the bus driver very gently put his hand on your shoulder and whisper in your ear, "The bus has broken down in the middle of nowhere."
Yeah, I would agree.
And we have to all take our luggage out of the bus right now, everything we own, stand on the highway in the pouring rain, and wait for a van to pick us all up. That's always the worst thing. Always. I don't know if it's the best live band, but my favorite show was Sisters of Mercy or Diamanda Galas, Plague Math. Plague Mass. Can't stop. That was pretty powerful.
I have to say, even though I'm not a fan, but the first time I saw Rammstein when we opened for them in Germany, I was pretty blown away. Just like the sound, the pyros, you know, everything was just like, boah.
Cleaning toilets in a nightclub.
Being a painter, like, you know, not, I mean, painting walls. Horrible.
Central Park.
Pink Beach, Bermuda.
Lots of latex.
You mean the strangest thing I pack
that you
for
pack
a tour?
For tour, yeah. There's stranger things than latex,
well,
but
this might be a little personal, but I'll share it anyways. What I do is I bring exactly as many pairs of underwear as I have dates, and I vacuum shrink wrap them so they don't take up so much space. And each time I open a new pack, I'm like, it's the smell of home, like my own laundry detergent. It's very strange, I know, but.
Well, I've always been preferential to Angelina Jolie. I like her. I'd have her play. Who would play you?
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
The physical resemblance is just staggering.
Striking. Mark Bolan, T-Rex.
I don't know, probably Robert Smith or something. You know, I was always, it was always male artists for me. Power to deceive
your wings. Pee Wee Herman. The most difficult song to record was a song that we did with Nina Hagen as a guest vocalist. Because she drank like 2 or 3 bottles of red wine. Then she was telling stories about aliens. And then she fell asleep. And the next day we reattempted to do this. And she ran like something like $5,000 a day. The next day she didn't even show up. She was drunk in the hotel room. And on the third day we finally got something going. But possibly about 8 words out of her. And that was about it. And we had to make a song with it because she was hired and she only agreed to do this with us if there was a song coming out of it that she could have some of the publishing for. So that was horrible, difficult. But she's very nice.
After all of that, yeah. But she's very nice.
No, she's super sweet. I mean, hey, thanks for watching Metal Injection. Pick up the new album, KMFDM Rocks. Well, it's not that new. It's like a personal favorite. Milestones Reloaded, September 9th. Thank you.
There.
Dino, pay later. This is Sasha from KMFDM and
Anish from KMFDM.
And you're watching Post.
And welcome back to Post. We are here bringing you KMFDM shot live, shot video-wise, that is, live at the Edge here in Palo Alto. And we want to chat with the two main guys in KMFDM. We have Anesh and Sasha. Thanks for joining us on the show.
Hi.
Good evening, good morning, good afternoon.
It's been, what, about 2 years since you were here last with playing with Ministry?
Actually, 15 months.
So a little more than 1 year. And now you're on tour as the headlining act with Brain Dead Sound Machine as the opening band. How do you think this, in a nutshell, how does this change things where you are now the headliner and not just, well, not that you weren't good with Ministry, but now you are on your own with Brain Dead Sound Machine?
Well, we're just having more fun like this. You know, we can give directions instead of being pushed around, so it's good.
Now, just briefly, Anesh, you were involved with the Pig Face project. Has all the flack from that died down? Have you now, have they asked you to do any shows with them? Have you done any shows with them?
Actually, I did one show, so we met the guys in Trenton, and I did one song, the Germ song, on the Pig Face album. That's it. I'm not able to do two tours in one moment.
Did you enjoy that?
Yeah, I like the guys, I like the band, I like the project, I like the ideology, so everybody can do what he wants and stuff like that, so, no.
Now,
yeah.
Now, KMFDM, let's see, there's been a new single just released called Split. I guess, is there going to be an album following that?
It is, yeah. It's an album, it's called Apart, isn't it? Yeah, it's out in fall, autumn.
So you finished recording it, now it just takes a while to get it processed?
We finished, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Now, as far as you can tell. Now, all of your albums are out on, of course, Wax Trax. Are there any other things that we might that might be sort of rare collectible things that are not part of the usual catalog that people might not know about?
Well, there is some records that have been released in Germany about 6 years ago, which will not be available ever again because, you know, it's just from the first days.
Right.
But basically all the material is out here. It's compiled on What Do You Know Deutschland.
And so you've been going for about, what, six, seven years now? Four albums? Well, five albums?
We just had 7 years anniversary 2 days ago. That was the first time that Kein Mehrheit für die Mitleid actually performed in Germany. Mm-hmm. What you waiting for? She has to be loved. Everybody needs a body. That's the way of the world. What you waiting for?
Who works on your videos? Do you do them yourself or?
We do all our stuff ourselves nowadays. We don't have producers or mixers or whatever. We just do it. Just recently, Anesh did a video for Naive, for that track. And it was sort of banned inside of Wax Trax, sort of self-censorship. And I think censorship is one of the basic points that we should maybe talk about here. KMFDM has been censored a couple of times. First time on MTV, where they beeped out some words in the More and Faster video. Second time, our album cover of the Naive album has been banned by some southern warehouse chains. And I mean, if you Americans, especially the young Americans, don't stand up against censorship and give away your right of free speech and free expression in return for a police state, you'll be pretty bad off very soon. I mean, if you're not bad off right now, actually.
Well, we'd be very happy to show all of your uncensored videos if you just get them to us. I don't think we have any problem with that. what are you going to do when you get back home to Germany?
Do another video that will be a victim for censorship. No, really, I mean, we're going to do some productions in the near future and just keep on working.
Well, I wish you well. Thanks for coming by. Well, thanks for coming back to town, that is. And we look forward to hearing more good stuff from you in the future. KMFDM here at the Edge in Palo Alto, and we're out of here. This is Post. You'll be gone live. Hope you enjoyed that. That was KMFDM, shot live at the Edge in Palo Alto. Well, that's it. The show is history.
Best industrial albums ever, but I have a feeling that you don't like the term industrial.
No, not really. I mean, we'd call it ultra-heavy beat rather than industrial. Industrial doesn't really say anything.
Right. Now, you guys are from Hamburg originally, and I suppose one of the first industrial bands would have been Einstürzende Neubauten. Were they much of an influence for you?
Not really. I mean, I would agree that they are totally industrial, like Test Department is too, but our influence is more like DAF, you know, mm-hmm. early sequencing, heartbeat kind of thing.
I know that earlier on you used to use vacuum cleaners to create your sound, is that right?
Yeah, we just did it for one show. We hooked up, I think, 16 vacuum cleaners through distortion pedals and just amplified it. Like.
But I played two dishwashers as well.
Yeah. Because back in the early days, industrial music really was kind of made banging on metal pieces and stuff
like
that.
Using
now it's all sequenced and all electronic.
Yeah, that's why I wouldn't call it industrial, really. It's more kind of electronic in the widest range possible, you know. It's like dance music, ultra-heavy beat.
Let's look at the new video from the fifth album from KMFDM. This is Vogue.
Hello, teenage America.
Vogue from KMFDM. Now, you guys spent a lot of time in Chicago. Is that where you shot that video?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was done last summer in basically two parts. One was Anesh, one was me, and we just blended it.
It's really funny to crawl over this bridge, no? It was,
yeah, you were doing a lot of crawling in that video.
Yeah, of course. It was 5 o'clock in the afternoon, so all the guys came from their offices. passing me like downtown, like, what's going on here? And I was half naked. So.
Okay, Vogue is the first video from KMFDM's latest album, Money. We're going to be talking more with them in the second 60 of 120 minutes.
Into the future.
Back to 120 minutes and willkommen auf 120 Minuten to KMFDM. Now, your new album is called Money, and you have a lot of female vocals on this one, as you have in your past records. Who are the female voices?
It differs. Like, on some songs, it's a friend of ours. On other songs, it's a sort of backing vocalist that does not want to be mentioned, really. Basically, we just like to work with kind of the sweetness of female vocals in a contrast to the harshness of the rest of the music.
Now, Anash, you've done some work with Pigface before. Are you going to go out on the road with them again?
Probably end of the year to Japan or so. And, it was really fun. This tour was really good. We did 70 gigs at all, and it was good to hang out with Augur from Skinny Puppy and Martin and Raven from
Killing Joke.
That's it. It's really good. No, I
and Raven and Augur are working on a project called Welt now.
Yeah, I think so. I will be involved as well. If I have time, my schedule is very tough. Our schedule is really tough.
So. Okay, will we see a KMFDM tour anytime soon?
Yeah, we're going to go on a European tour pretty soon, and we'll be here in the fall.
Okay.
Basically.
All right, well, thanks a lot for coming by, and we'll see you then.
Thank you.
Okay.
Und ihr Sound lässt Tote wieder auferstehen. KMFDM, die Dinosaurier des tanzbaren Industrial, haben alle Höhen und Tiefen des Musikgeschäfts überlebt.
What's your name, man?
KMFDM.
KMFMDM. You know, Muggy, you gotta know that, man. Well, I want to come back there, but fucking hanging out with KMFMDM. I can't even fucking say it.
Da drüben brennt Licht und es ist warm, also gehe ich mal rein.
Mitte der 80er, als ihre Kollegen aus der Industrial-Szene auf Baustellenrohre hämmern und Sägen aufheulen lassen, katapultieren KMFDM die Musik in die digitale Ära und erfinden den elektronischen Industrial. 27 Jahre und 17 Alben später gilt die Band, deren Name ausgeschrieben, kein Mitleid für die Mehrheit bedeutet, als Referenz für Leute wie Trent Reznor von Nine Inch Nails oder den grausigen Marilyn Manson.
I was really bored with the music in the sort of.
Mich hat die Musik der Post-Punk-Ära ziemlich gelangweilt.
You know, all this sort of gothic stuff.
Dieser ganze Gothic-Kram war tödlich.
Deadly boring and I wanted something snappy with machines.
Ich wollte etwas Fetziges mit Maschinen, Rhythmus, sehr elektronisch und funky.
And funky, you know, just.
Und am Ende wurde es super funky.
I think the influence in KMFDM,
die tanzbaren Einflüsse von KMFDM kamen alle schon sehr früh. Dieser Teil unserer Inspiration stammt eher von Sachen wie ABBA.
Stuff like, say, ABBA.
Genau wie ABBA ist KMFDM ein Akronym. Und wie die Schweden den Disco, holen die Deutschen den Industrial aus einem Ghetto der digitalen Rhythmen. Der Sound von KMFDM bläst zu der Zeit alles weg.
Thank you.
Meine Mutter ist gebürtige Düsseldorferin. Und als sie zwischen 10 und 12 Jahre alt war, verbrachte sie jede Nacht in einem Bunker, weil es ständig Bomben- und Fliegeralarm gab. Diese Geschichten haben mich geprägt.
Als Sohn eines Kunsthändlers und einer Antiquarin wird Sascha Konietzko 1961 in Hamburg geboren, nahe dem Star-Club, in dem die Beatles ihr Debüt gaben. 10 Jahre später kauft er sich einen Bass und entdeckt nach ein paar Glamrock-Jahren den Punk.
When I was 11 years old, I bought Mit 11 kaufte ich mein erstes Album, The Slider von T-Rex. Ich hörte es mir immer wieder an und dachte, wie wird man so? Ich fragte mich, wie schafft man es, sein Gesicht auf ein Plattencover zu kriegen? Wie macht man das alles? Das war sehr faszinierend für mich.
...1984 fährt Sascha ein paar befreundete Künstler nach Paris zu deren Ausstellung im Grand Palais. Vor Ort improvisiert er ein Konzert mit 4 zufällig hereingeschneiten Polen und einem seiner Bildhauerkumpel.
Auf dem Weg nach Paris meinte einer, es wäre toll, zusätzlich zu den Installationen auch noch einen Sound zu haben. Ein anderer deutete auf mich, er kann Bass spielen. Wir mieteten also Bassverstärker, ein paar Staubsauger und Mikrofone und machten dann diese Geräuschinstallation.
Direkt danach gründet Sascha KMFDM, jobbt aber auch weiterhin nebenher. Innerhalb von 5 Jahren macht sich die Hitsband einen Namen, indem sie ausgiebig durch Westdeutschland tourt. ...1989 dann die Überraschung. KMFDM werden von Wax Trax, dem Pionierlabel für Elektrorock, eingeladen, als Vorgruppe der US-Band Ministry zu spielen. Und nach einem erfolgreichen Konzert in Chicago unter Vertrag genommen. Außer Ministry begegnet die Band auch Front 242, den Young Gods und der durchgeknallten Muse von John Waters, die zur Königin der Club-Music mutiert, die gewichtige Divine. Ich saß beim Label und fragte, und verkaufen sich die Platten von KMFDM? Und die Leute meinten, ja, schon. Ich fragte, wie viele? Und sie antworteten, an die 84.000. Wenn wir 500 Platten in Deutschland verkauften, war das schon toll. Aber 84.000 in Amerika? Ich dachte, hier bleibe ich. Das ist klasse.
Very, very unstable and unpredictable.
Who's a good boy, Zero?
That's not enough.
Anfang der 90er schwimmt Saschas Band auf der Welle des Industrial Metal, behält aber noch einen Fuß im Dance-Bereich. So klettern KMFDM bis auf Platz 10 der Billboard-Charts und verkaufen fast 2 Millionen Singles. Zusätzlich gepusht wird die Band durch einen Clip in Beavis and Butthead und ein Intermezzo in Beverly Hills. 1999 dann die Katastrophe. Die Boulevardpresse nennt ihren Namen in Zusammenhang mit den Columbine-Killern. Die Täter hatten das Datum ihres Massakers genau auf den Erscheinungstermin des Albums Adios abgestimmt.
Playing with fire in a way.
Wir spielten mit dem Feuer. Das wurde uns zum Verhängnis, als es zu der Schießerei an der Columbine High School kam. Plötzlich wurden alle Slogans und Kontexte, die zu KMFDM gehörten, auseinandergenommen und unter dem Mikroskop seziert. Und wenn man Sachen so aus dem Zusammenhang reißt, kann man die Bedeutung natürlich auch beliebig manipulieren. Wir wurden viele Jahre lang nicht mehr im Radio gespielt.
Was würdest du auf deinen Grabstein schreiben?
He loved it. Er liebte es. Das würde ich schreiben. Er hat es verdammt nochmal geliebt.
He fucking loved it. Hey, I'm Sasha from KMFDM. How are you?
Over the years, you've used quite a few languages, with the newest being Russian on the song Davai from Blitz. What is it that draws you to different languages?
It's just, it's kind of fun, you know, the German-English thing is kind of already part of KMFDM. And at some point there was a song in French, and it was just like, why not something else? Why not something Spanish, Russian, maybe next time Japanese? And, you know, it was kind of fun.
Now, you've had no singles since Boots in 2002. How come?
Singles are not really what people want anymore. You know? It's like the days of singles are really kind of over. That said, we do the 24/7 single release, 24 vinyl, 7 inches, classic A and B side stuff. And, you know, singles are more like now it's vinyl, it's more like a collector's item. But really, the days of promoting like an album by putting out a single and that shit is kind of, it's over.
Okay.
Thanks to music piracy.
Yeah. Now, on your last three albums, you've had had a couple cover songs. Is that something you think you'll continue on future releases, or were those just something that kind of came up and just worked with those albums?
It seems like every time I sort of start to do something a few times after another, I have to break the mold. So. Maybe not, I don't know. It just felt like there were a couple of songs I needed to get out of my system. I think I got them out now.
But you said that Bitches was about the bad fans rather than the normal self-depreciating KMFDM songs that you seem to traditionally write. Was there a specific incident that triggered that song? Or?
Not at all. It's all like tongue-in-cheek stuff. I mean, you know, of course I wouldn't say anything serious at all. It's just kind of just needed to be done that way.
Me and My Gun is a fun song for sure, but I noticed that you have that little public service announcement in there. Was that something that you felt you needed to do after being linked to the school shootings?
No, that's an homage to my doctor. He's actually from the South.
Okay. But you and Tim Skold seem to work well together. Why did he leave after Attack in the first place?
He got offered like a well-paying job with Marilyn Manson. And he would have been stupid not to take it.
Okay.
And he milked it for as long as he could.
Sure. And then, so he came back a little bit on Blitz, and you guys worked together on Skold versus KMFDM.
Actually, no, it was the other way around. I was kind of halfway into Blitz.
Right.
In the summer last year, 2008, and Tim let me know that he was off to Manson and wanted to do something, and I was kind of like, yeah, I'd like to do something else too, because having worked for 5-6 months on Blitz, I was kind of like ready to take a break, step aside, you know, just get my head into something new. And so we worked on Skold vs. KMFDM for 101 days precisely. And I just got so used to working with him. again, you know, during that period of time, that I was like, why don't you do like sort of final instance on production checking on Blitz, you know? So I shot all the stuff over to him, and you know, just let me know where things needed a bit of help, and you know, what was finished on a couple of faders and buttons, and it's good.
So have you guys talked about having him come back to KMFDM at all? Or?
I don't think it's the right time, neither for us nor for him, to really rejoin KMFDM, because you know, Tim was a member at the time where KMFDM was a more sort of open, more revolving kind of policy. And in the meantime, KMFDM formed as a pretty, you know, steady outfit, really. And I think our time is better spent on doing stuff on the side, as opposed to KMFDM.
You and Lucia being over in Europe now, and pretty much writing Blitz mostly yourself. Is that a style you can see continuing, or do you think you'll get back into doing more of the collaboration stuff like it used to be? Or?
It's really hard to predict like what's going to happen, what will be the situation at some time in the future when you intend to make a new album. So I can't really tell you that, because we'll just see. You know, it might be that Andy and Jules may be super busy with their project, the Spitting Cobras, and in that case, you know, it's probably going to be mostly Lucia and myself doing that next step in writing, or it might be some completely different situation. It's really hard to predict that. At any rate, there will be a new KMFDM album in the not-so-distant future.
That's good to know. Now, you said in a previous interview that you no longer talk to Raymond Watts. Is that true?
Yeah, I haven't spoken to him since probably 4 or 5 years now.
What happened with that?
I don't know, we just stopped talking.
Just kind of fell out of contact?
Kind of, sort of, you know, there was not really a reason to pick up the phone in the meantime.
Okay. That's about all I got. You got anything else you want to say to your fans?
Well, I want to let you know that I can literally dance in my pants. We just switched tour buses 2 days ago, and we got a bus that was sitting on a lot for like 3 months, and has ants on it. And I'm fucking itching. Seriously. You think I'm kidding? I'm not.
From the mid-80s forth, KMFDM has always kept their politically driven angst at the forefront of their persona. Between bitter no-nonsense fuck-the-system lyrics, harsh and heavy guitar riffs, and the wonderful war propaganda of Aidan Hughes, how is it that the band has kept its message so clear throughout the years?
Well, I guess you either write, you know, shallow lyrics of some sort of personal or impersonal nature, or you have something to say. And in our case, there's just something to be said.
Yeah. There always seems to be something to be said.
There's never any lack of inspiration.
Yeah. Now, you guys have been faithful to your album artist, Aidan Hughes, a.k.a. Brute. How did you end up working together, and what about his artwork stood out to the KMFDM cause?
Well, our first record sported a photograph of Irina Gorbachev, the daughter of Michael Gorbachev, and then was licensed to the UK. Mm-hmm. And just as they did in those days, they were like, you know, same record, different cover.
Right.
Catch me as you can, you know. And so that's how that's how I met Aidan. And I never thought we would even do like a follow-up record.
Right.
And then we did a single that was done with a little rubber stamp artwork. And then we actually did another album and just contacted Aidan to see if he would do it again. And then, you know, I just had no one better to do anything cover art-wise. And so after 5 years, it was just like, you know, naturally call that guy again and again and again and again and again. And at one time I couldn't find him. And that's that was the Nihil cover, which was done by Bill Rieflin's wife, the then Ministry drummer.
Right. Yeah, I mean, anytime you see any of Brute's artwork, I think everybody thinks of KMFDM. It's just become so synonymous.
It's a brand. It's a total visual brand. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, as a group, KMFDM has had many shifts in members and collaborators. What is the common element that you look for in potential collaborators?
That they deliver. I mean, collaborations are hard insofar as you can't really tell a collaborator what to do.
Right.
You sort of have to trust that their talent and their inspiration will sort of kick the ball around and, you know, but still keep it in the court. Mm-hmm. There are collaborations, or there have been collaborations, that have derailed, and the outcome was just not anything that could be released, in my opinion.
Right.
So it's always hit or miss. Mm-hmm. I would say the one thing that is different in the KMFDM collaborations than, say, for instance, Pigface, mm-hmm. is that I was never geared to like name drop, but there's collaborations with people that were completely unknown, and then somehow, maybe because of the collaboration or due to other reasons, you know, became someone on the map, so to speak.
Right.
And I've been given one chance, like one big chance in my life, mm-hmm. and I like to pay back the good karma, you know. So,
if you could explain to your fans what to expect from Kunst, what would you say?
Check it out. It's really hard for the proverbial artist to explain his work, mm-hmm. and it's very hard for me to talk about something that is just so fresh.
You know? Right.
I still hear every fader move and can't really say anything about it. It's the logical continuation of where What the Fuck left off.
Right.
And I think it's a better record.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah, I mean,
but
really,
I mean, for me, any record just has to meet one criteria, and that's a very easy criteria to meet, because it's a snapshot of where the band is at the time of the making,
mm-hmm.
and it reflects the inspiration. So it kind of dates itself in a way,
right.
a little bit. But that's okay, because with the continuity of records coming out of this camp, a dated record is okay.
Right. Yeah, and really, like these days, you don't really need to ask somebody so much what an album sounds like when you can just go on Spotify and stream it and hear for yourself.
Right, exactly. You know. Interesting thing about KMFDM is that it seems to be very polarizing. Mm-hmm. There's no... I don't know of anyone that thinks it's okay. I know people that hate it, and I know a lot of people that love it.
Yeah, yeah, it definitely does seem to be the case.
It's just something you either get or don't, which I don't mean like, wow, man, you have to be really fucking this or that smart or something to get it, but it's its own little beast.
We remember Skold versus KMFDM.
Yep.
What was it like working with a former collaborator like that?
It was natural. It was really easy. We exchanged files on a daily basis. He was 9 hours ahead of me. No, behind me, actually.
Mm-hmm.
So when my day ended, his day just kind of begun.
Sure.
And we got, in 101 days total, we got 202 working days in.
Mm-hmm.
That was pretty good.
Nice. Well, that album came out really good. I like that one a lot.
It's very different, yeah.
Yeah, it is, but still really good. All right. Now, KMFDM are the pioneers of the ultra-heavy beat. Are there any other artists you feel are deserving of the label as well, or do you feel KMFDM is kind of in a genre all its own?
No, I don't feel that way, but... I mean, we kind of just like, I don't know, we come from a time when genres of music were kind of like a very loose kind of thing.
Sure.
And we didn't fit into any genre, so we just came up with our own definition of it. And I mean, I don't spend much time thinking about like who is ultra heavy beat or who's not. It's just like one little facet of KMFDM's history. Mm-hmm. Possibly Chant, the guys that are opening tonight.
Sure.
Maybe they're the ultra heavy beat. Do you know Chant?
Oh, we do know Chant. We're actually friends with Bradley. So.
Cool. One of my favorite bands, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, I've seen him.
And I mean, I have maybe like already. Two favorite bands. So.
Yeah. Cool. All right, and finally, what are some unexpected influences of KMFDM?
Well, I mean, the whole Pussy Riot trial in Russia, mm-hmm. that was something that, you know, just like blam, spawned a song in like a day or so. Mm-hmm. And there's always stuff like that. I mean, something happens and, you know, you just get into it. You sort of, you know, get angry about it or something, and it triggers a reaction, of course.
Right. So pretty much you see something that, you know, causes some emotion in you, and that could be cause for a song.
Yeah, of course. Inspiration is just everywhere.
All right.
Unless you live on the North Pole without television, you know, there's enough inspiration.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you very much for the interview. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.
There was no desire to play in Europe, and we didn't do too swell in Europe before. So distribution was
part of the distribution didn't work too well, and we didn't sell basically too much records, so we didn't expect a kind of response that
as opposed to the States.
Well, if you're talking about live, a lot of people are laid back. They listen to, they go to a concert like going to an opera and stuff. In America, people are more wild. They go more nuts, and that's kind of cool. So at least you have like a feeling something is happening and you can go to it. So.
The strangest or the oddest place you ever played live?
In Atlanta. And it wasn't too good because we're not a band for all kinds, so that's another reason not to do Lollapalooza or something, because it doesn't make sense, because we will end up anyway to play at 4 in the afternoon or so. Of course we're a band working with pre-production and to pre-program stuff on stage. We don't play everything live. It wouldn't mean too much to do that. So that's the reason why it's probably better to play at more spots at the light show, the big rock show, instead of being like really natural in the daylight. It's not happening. So.
What other work are you doing besides working with
KMFDM? Recently, I remixed a band from Long Island, New York, called Terminal Sect. It's kind of nice work. I work permanently and stuff at home, so I have a workstation at home, sampler. I'm working on more solo stuff, so there will be solo album coming out sooner or later. I'm pretty busy with the tour. After that, it might go on to the end, so take
a while. Do you think
you'll be doing
any more solo work?
Yeah,
I will.
Cheesy albums? Yeah. Work with Big Face again?
No, Big Face is not happening for me again. I had a disagreement with the label, so me and Martin Atkins don't get along too well anymore, as a matter of fact. So, I like the experience, I like the band, but there were certain factors that I couldn't agree on, so I decided not to do it anymore. It's too bad.
So what's in the future for
now? Nobody knows. Staying alive. Be creative, of course. Do more for myself. For myself.
And another cigarette?
What's that?
And another cigarette?
And smoke more cigarettes.